Hispanics are responsible for 50% of Nebraska's population growth in the last decade. They are Nebraska's largest minority community. Yet they continue to battle long-standing discrimination and health disparities, and those have only increased with COVID-19. We'll look closer at the Latino experience in our state tonight on Speaking of Nebraska. Thanks for joining us on this special edition of Speaking of Nebraska. I'm NET News Director Dennis Kellogg. Tonight we're focusing our entire program on the Latino experience in Nebraska, just as we did recently on the Black experience in our state. Ray Aguilar, Nebraska's first Latino state senator, has returned to the legislature after a decade. We asked him from his perspective about being the first and whether he's seen life for Latinos improving in recent years.
Basically, it's something I don't think about. I'm still proud of the fact that I was the first one in the position. But since that time, a lot has gone under the bridge, and I don't really think about it that much anymore. I think we are making progress in that sense. There's still systematic problems in the fact that we still have a lot of new immigrants that coming in, and that bothers a lot of people. So that's something that's still a concern, and we need to address as it happens, you know, and kind of slow down the immigration if possible until these people have a chance to acclimate and possibly become citizens. The biggest change has to come from within. I mean, people have to be accepting, as well as immigrant population has to want to move forward and be part of our communities and be part of our citizenship.
Joining us now are Dr. Athena Ramos, an associate professor at the University of Nebraska Medical Center, and Dr. Lazaro Espindola, the executive director of the state's Latino American Commission. Thank you both for being with us today. We really appreciate it. Historically, we know the Omaha stockyards and packing plants brought many Latin American immigrants to Omaha in the early 20th century. Latinos now make up more than 11% of the population in Nebraska. And as you look back over the last century, how would you describe the Latino and Hispanic experience, and how has that changed during that time? Is it improving, do you think? Dr. Espinola, we'll start with you.
Well, first of all, you need to differentiate between people who came here prior to 1990, who went to those packing plants, who were working at the railroad industry, and then who had children and grandchildren who are now second, third, fourth generation Latinos. And those who came after 1990, who were a much younger population, they were brought mostly by the meatpacking plants to alleviate the shortage of hand labor. And now their children are becoming much better acclimated to the American dream. But they are still, you know, hardworking people who have not really had the time to assimilate the country or the society as a whole.
Dr. Ramos, same question to you. How would you describe the Latino experience in Nebraska, and is it improving?
Well, I think it's changing for sure. And I think we're seeing a lot of these changes happen in smaller communities where many of these meat processing facilities are located. We're seeing towns that were traditionally German or Polish or Czech now becoming majority minority communities. You take, for example, the case of Lexington or Schuyler, which are now over 70% Hispanic. So I think there's definitely been a demographic shift happening, particularly in the rural communities throughout our state. And I think there are definitely some examples of organizing that is going on where you're seeing Latinos come through the community who have maybe been immigrants to the community and now stepping into leadership roles. Schuyler is a perfect example, a case in point, where you have a number of people who came as immigrants and who are now elected officials in their community. And so they're starting to take on more of those leadership roles within communities. So I think we are seeing a shift. We're starting to see a change.
Absolutely.
And I think there's more to come.
Of course, over the last year, we've all dealt with a couple of major topics, racial injustice and also obviously the COVID-19 pandemic. We've heard calls to address racial injustice in the Black community. We've also heard that from the Latino community as well, but that may not have received as much attention. Dr. Espindola, how does the Latino and Black community experience work together, especially when it comes with the fight for racial injustice, fight against racial injustice?
Well, we both have a similar goal. In other words, to achieve equity and justice for our particular communities. In the case of the African American community, they have a much longer history of injustice and a much more severe one, but they're also much better politically organized. The Latino community is not as well politically organized in that sense, but now, as Athena mentioned, there are individuals who are stepping up to leadership positions and trying to at least go up to the level where the African American community is.
Dr. Ramos, let's talk about the other half of that equation, then the COVID-19 pandemic and how Hispanics have been impacted. Let's begin with vaccinations. Now, when it comes to the number of Hispanics fully vaccinated nationwide, it's below the percentage of the overall Hispanic population. So do you think it's a case of this community being hesitant about the vaccine, or do you think it has to do more with the availability of the vaccine in these communities?
Well, I think it's a combination of many factors, not just the two things that you mentioned. I think there are definitely structural issues that we have to take into account. For example, how vaccine is distributed throughout states, across states and throughout communities, who's prioritized and who's not. There's been a number of examples where rhetoric that has made its way into the media has had an influence on people's decisions. For example, earlier in the year, I'm sure you remember, the governor had made some comments about prioritizing legal immigrants and citizens and not making the vaccine available for undocumented people. That type of rhetoric also sends fear throughout the community and makes people less likely to access those vaccines because they're afraid of the consequences that might come to them or to their families for accessing it. So there's some structural issues. There's also some sociocultural issues in terms of, you know, health beliefs and was it developed with enough time? Was there enough science behind it? There's a lot of people who are fearful, thinking that it was developed too quickly. There's a lot of myths out there about the vaccine and a lot of misinformation. And some of that is playing into people's decisions on whether or not to be able to access the vaccine. And then, of course, there's logistical issues of who's getting the vaccine, when is it available, who has time to take off to go get it if it's not being available at the work site. So there's multiple factors. This is a very complex question. And so to throw it all in the bucket of vaccine hesitancy, I wouldn't do that. I think we need to look more at the way that we have made the vaccine available structurally and logistically, and then also think about some of those sociocultural influences.
Yeah, and there is also a demographical issue here. Latinos over 50%, over 50 years of age, are much more willing to have the vaccine, provided that someone that they trust, like their medical provider, tells them that they need to do so. Those under 50 years of age are less or more hesitant, as Athena mentioned, probably because they've been more exposed to all the misinformation that has been going out in the social media. So, and of course, if the priority is the elder population, you got to remember that the Latino population is relatively young. So they haven't yet gotten to the point where they are being offered the vaccine.
So is there something we're not doing that we should be doing to reach this community?
With education, vaccine? Education, information, not just, government flyers or TV shows or something. We should be reaching out to the people, to the natural leaders of these communities, the people that the people trust, persuade them to reach out to their constituents and explain the benefits and the side effects of the vaccine, because that's another problem. We have tended to downplay the side effects of the vaccine, which sometimes can be quite disagreeable, but people want the truth. So if you tell somebody the vaccine will do nothing to you and then they have a severe reaction to the vaccine, like pain or fever or headaches, then they will think that you're lying to them, and the second dose becomes problematic.
Dr. Ramos, you've done some research, I believe, on health disparities mm-hmm. with minority communities. And what have you found out about how immigrants integrate into the health community and what kind of disparities they face when they get there?
Sure. Our community has less access to health care in general. We have less access to health insurance. In fact, we're about 3 times less likely to have health insurance compared to the general population. There are enormous health disparities. I think one of the things that our community, our Latino community, has going for us is something that we call the immigrant, the healthy immigrant paradox. So as we've talked about, you know, our community tends to be younger. And so sometimes we don't face the same chronic health conditions right now because our community is younger. But over time, we're seeing that the health of the community, of the immigrant community, starts to come into line with that of the native community. So that is one of the things that we are seeing. In terms of integration, though, I think we as a Nebraska community need to do a better job of being welcoming and being proactive and really intentional about welcoming people into our communities and creating systems that are going to help people do that. Instead of denying the fact that people are coming or you know, trying to push people away. The fact is we need people in our state. We have lots of jobs that are available. Companies are going to continue to try to attract people to come here to work. And we should be creating, you know, the structure, the infrastructure in communities to help people be successful. That's what we want. We want people in our state who can be successful. And so why not work together to create more multilingual infrastructure? Why not figure out ways to provide health education to communities? Why not work with all those community organizations and bring them into the fold? Instead of calling on organizations right when we need them, we should be working together all the time. These are things that we should be doing.
And this is so true, what Athena just said, that if you think about the original immigration wave to Nebraska, which came from Eastern Europe, when you go to Schuyler, you see that at the beginning of the 1900s, there were 2 newspapers in Schuyler, and they were both in Czech. You go to the Madison Museum in Norfolk, and you will find out the office of the very first doctor in Norfolk, who was a German, because the German settlers in Norfolk wanted a doctor who spoke their language. So this is nothing new, and this is nothing, you know, sophisticated or brought out of I don't know where. This is the natural way for people to think. Now, we had World War I here, where the enemy was actually Eastern Europe, the Austro-Prussian Empire. And then there were laws passed against speaking German or Czech or any other language. And that forced the children of these immigrants to learn English and to think in English and to behave as much as possible as the dominant population. But that hasn't happened, so we're not in war with Latin America.
I want to follow up on something that's come up already in the conversation about, you've mentioned that your community is younger, and 2012 research from the University of Nebraska at Omaha found that Hispanics are a much younger population in the Omaha metro area specifically. The median age was 23. For whites, it was twice that, as high as 40. So what brings about that age disparity? How do you interpret it?
Well, there's lots of reasons for that. One is that people will say, well, people who immigrate from another country tend to be younger, they tend to be healthier, because they can make that journey. They can come and start a whole new life in a whole new place with, you know, a whole new culture and language and so forth. So that's one explanation that there is. There's also a higher fertility rate among our community. So on average, our families tend to be a little bit larger than the general population. So that also lends itself to the difference in age, in the age demographic.
Dr. Espindola, staying with a little bit of topic about health disparities, you're a surgeon before immigrating to the United States.
Yes.
And you've been in public health for a long time. You're a medical expert. How do you see the health disparities overall in Nebraska?
Mostly related to money. The biggest factor in health is the amount of money that you make, the amount of money that you have, which will give you access to the highest possible quality of care. That happens in the United States. Most of the Latino immigrants come from countries that, about 30 countries, which have what we call a national healthcare system. And that doesn't exist here in the United States. So they are facing the high cost of the American healthcare system procedures. So mostly has to do with that. And it also has a lot to do with the lack of health insurance, as Athena mentioned. And then there is also a lack of health information in inappropriate language, simple enough language. Mm-hmm. I mean, whenever you receive, here in the United States, we love receiving information. But then that information tends to become more and more technical. If you consider the fact that most of the newly arrived Latino immigrants never really finish high school, the more technical that you get, the farther that you get away from them. They don't really understand what you're saying. But now there is a big push to make appropriate healthcare literacy for individuals like that, not only Hispanics, but also Asians or people from the Middle East, et cetera.
And even for English speakers, to ensure that our health education materials are at an appropriate literacy level. That's a common problem across all people.
There was a study conducted at the Boston Hospital, at the Massachusetts General Hospital about 12 years ago, where they tried to gauge how much information given by the doctor was retained by the patient. And it turned out that only about 25% of the information was retained by English speakers.
I was going to ask, is that Spanish speakers? That was English speakers.
Those were the English speakers.
Well, we all know that the pandemic has exacerbated health disparities for minority communities in particular. And according to the Department of Health and Human Services, data on the pandemic, Hispanics appear to be testing positive and being hospitalized at a greater rate than the percentage they make up in the population. There is, however, some unknowns with a lack of reporting on ethnicity in the DHHS data. So, Dr. Ramos, how has the pandemic, do you feel, impacted Hispanics compared with whites and with other communities of color?
Well, I think it's had a tremendous impact, both in terms of the healthcare outcomes, the health outcomes associated with the pandemic, but also in terms of the social outcomes related to the pandemic, which have resulted in people losing their jobs, getting their hours cut, having to find ways to care for their families, and trying to make adjustments. I mean, we've all had to make adjustments, but I think oftentimes in our communities, people are working in what we call now essential jobs. Jobs that, for the most part, we never thought of as essential before the pandemic, unfortunately. And so these folks, they didn't have the option to work from home. And so they had to go into work, but that didn't change the fact that the schools are closed, the daycares have been closed, that, you know, maybe their partner lost their job. And so trying to make all of that work has been really, really, I think, difficult for a lot of families, and they face some serious challenges in doing so. If we take, for example, in the meatpacking industry here in Nebraska, we've had over 7,200 cases of people who have tested positive who are working in these plants, which has resulted in 27 deaths among meatpacking workers in our state. And we know that the majority of people who are working in meat processing facilities in Nebraska are Hispanic and Latino, sometimes immigrants from Latin America, but of Hispanic Latino descent.
So, Dr. Espindola, let's take that topic a little bit further, if we can. Obviously, the meatpacking plants have been a big part of this issue with the pandemic. The Lincoln Journal Star in July reported almost 60% of the state's COVID cases were Hispanic. Only 11% of the population, of course, is Hispanic. So early on, meatpacking plants were hot spots for the virus. Now, those in the meatpacking plants are in the process of getting vaccinated. But should those workers have been prioritized sooner? And how do you think overall, again, that the vaccination process has worked for this community?
Of course, it should have been prioritized sooner. I mean, at the beginning, the meatpacking plants were relatively slow in implementing the necessary preventive measures to keep their workers from being affected by the COVID-19 virus. but then they took some measures, but yet there are still high-risk individuals. So they should have had a priority in that sense.
Mm-hmm. And there was some back and forth in terms of the prioritization of essential workers. Mm-hmm. So there was a national strategy, a consensus strategy that was put forth that had put essential workers into like a category 2. The CDC came back and said, no, we'll move them back to 1B, which would be a little bit higher priority, which was good. But then you saw that there were some changes in who was considered in 1B. It was 75 and older. They rolled it back to 65 and older. Some states said, well, we're going to do, you know, this population first, because within each one of those categories, there's lots of people who fit into those categories of essential workers, age, you know, whatever, and older, and chronic conditions, so forth. And so you've seen a lot of states that have very different priorities. And even in Nebraska, I think there's been a lot of fluctuation of where do I fit? And each county has taken a little bit different approach.
And of course, the legislature is considering LB 241, which is a bill that would enact safety precautions in meatpacking plants. That's been prioritized. So we'll see where that one ends up. I want to step back just a little bit, though, and talk about the growing Latino population in our state. In nearly the last decade, Hispanics or Latinos made up nearly half of the state's population growth. So I guess the obvious question is, why do you think the Latino population is growing at such a high rate? What's attractive about Nebraska, Dr. Mm-hmm. Ramos?
Well, I think there's a couple of reasons why the population is growing. Of course, there are people who are coming from other places who are immigrating to Nebraska. But a lot of the growth that's happening in our state right now is the natural growth of families who may have come in the 1990s, yeah. with the packing plants, who started their lives here, have their families here, their kids have grown up here, and they continue to stay here. They've made the choice to stay in Nebraska and start their own families here. So I think a lot of it is really that natural growth that is happening.
And there are job opportunities here. I mean, Latinos come to the United States looking for a better life for them and for their children. And Nebraska has the good life, right? Or at least it used to. So now lately we have been seeing a lot of immigrants of Cuban origin that are coming down from Florida looking for those opportunities.
Also want to talk about a national issue here when it comes to DACA, or the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, another much debated federal policy. It allows children brought to the United States unlawfully to stay for 2 years and become eligible for work permits. Frida Aguilera is a junior at the University of Nebraska at Lincoln and a DACA recipient. She came to the U.S. from Mexico when she was 6 years old.
It's been quite a journey. At least now I can breathe somewhat, but there's still, you know, some space of uncertainty. Yeah, it's been pretty stressful, to say the least, just not knowing where my future is going to head. So at least now, you know, with the different administration, there's some sort of mobility within there. But still, you know, my future isn't in my own hands, which is very frustrating and very stressful. So,
Dr. Espindola, how have these young adults been impacted through the DACA process?
How have what?
How have they been impacted? How has it affected their lives?
Well, all their life they have been living under the fear that they would be deported to a country where they might have been born, but that they don't know. Many of them don't even speak the language very well. And they actually are not familiar with the society in those countries, but they could have been detained at any moment and deported. By allowing them a path to legal presence in the United States, you will do away with that fear. And believe me, if you live all your life with the fear that you do not belong there, that you will be kicked out of a place, you don't really feel attached to that place. I mean, what kind of loyalty can you develop for a nation that doesn't want you there?
Dr. Ramos, President Biden and the Democrats on Capitol Hill are calling for an 8-year path to citizenship and for most of the 11 million undocumented immigrants in the country, and expanding worker visas as well. What do you think, from your perspective, is the answer to, and I know that's a very simplified question because we've been dealing with this for decades, but how do you think we should be approaching immigration?
Well, I think we do need to have a more comprehensive approach to immigration reform. I think this idea of doing one little piece here of DACA or of the temporary protected status, the TPS, or doing something with the H-2A program, which is the guest workers who are in, farm workers. Doing little pieces without a more comprehensive approach, I think, is really difficult and detrimental to the overall well-being of the community and to the political process. I mean, it takes a lot of political will to get things to change. And I think if we were to actually tackle it once, you know, and do a really good job at it, that hopefully we could resolve a lot of the issues that have come out of this piecemeal approach.
Right. And we need to stop thinking about, you know, my great-grandparents came here illegally. Well, I mean, legally. Well, what legally or how legally? What laws were there when the first immigration law written was the Chinese Exclusion Act that was in the 1800s? And from then on, we have been seeing increasingly laws that are increasingly high barriers to people who immigrate. And sometimes, depending on the needs of the country, like when World War I and World War II, those barriers are lower and workers are allowed to come in massively. And then after the national emergency ends, they are deported massively too. So as Athena said, we need to have some sort of immigration reform that sets the rules of the game in place. Right now we have rules that change. I will not say on a yearly basis, but on a constant basis. So
we just have a little bit over a minute left. So I just want to get impression from both of you briefly. Where are we going as far as the Latino community is concerned? Do you feel optimistic about where this community is headed, Dr. Ramos?
Yes, I definitely feel optimistic. I'm very proud of my roots and of my community, and I'm excited to work with many of our community partners to try to make Nebraska a better state for everybody.
I'm even more optimistic. The Latino community is a vibrant, a creative, entrepreneurial community. We had a study that showed that Latino-owned businesses in Nebraska had grown up by about 86% in 5 years, where all the other ethnicities combined had grown by only about 2.4%. So yeah, we are an influx of energy into this state, and we all want the state to be better and to prosper.
And Dr. Ramos, last word, what's the biggest challenge this Latino community faces?
That's a great question. You caught me off guard on that one. That's a really hard question to answer. I'm not quite sure that I can tell you the most pressing issue. There's a lot of pressing issues. I think we've got to work on issues related to education, to healthcare, to language access, and to building political power and getting people involved in the political process, voting, registering to vote, and being engaged civically.
Dr. Athena Ramos from the University of Nebraska Medical Center, thank you. And Dr. Lazaro Espendola from the Latino America Commission, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Both of you for being with us. This interview and tonight's program are available on our website. Just go to netnebraska.org/speakingofnebraska and join the conversation on social media. Find us on Facebook and Twitter at NET News Nebraska. That's all for this week on Speaking of Nebraska. Join us next week for an episode on what it's like for high school seniors in Nebraska graduating in a pandemic. Until then, I'm NET News Director Dennis Kellogg. Thanks for spending some time with us. We'll see you next week.